We also have Kelvin Chang, who is the head of talent networking here, or director of talent networking here at SG Innovate. He's a senior developer. He's going to run through some of the, run through the SDK as well as some of the demo apps available on Hashgraph. And then after that, we will open it up to Q&A. So I'm sure all of you have many questions for us. So to just kick it off, I'd like to introduce Mance Harmon.
Okay, good evening. Thank you. Thank you for being here. I'm going to just dive right into the presentation here, if we can. So Swirlz is a company that's been around for a couple of years. We were first incorporated in Q4 of 2015. We are VC-backed, led by Enterprise Associates, and we're based in Dallas, Texas. We also have an office in New York City, and as Edgar said, we're now opening an office here in Singapore. Edgar is leading up that effort for us. Yeah, so background, just a little bit about me and Lehman. Lehman Baird is the inventor of the Hashgraph. He's a PhD from Carnegie Mellon University. He and I have been working together since 1993. Our formal background is in machine learning and AI. We started by working for the Air Force Senior Scientist for Machine Intelligence on a team of five back in the 90s doing reinforcement learning before it was a thing. Well, it was a thing back then, just nobody heard of it. But doing reinforcement learning with deep learning, convolutional networks back then. We both taught computer science at the U.S. Air Force Academy. I was a course director for cybersecurity there. Lehman was a full professor. I managed a massive software program for the Missile Defense Agency in the U.S. Lehman and I decided we were going to become entrepreneurs. We started our first company together. It was an identity management company. We sold that to a Fortune 500. I became the head of cybersecurity, product security for that same company. And we started our second company, another identity company, sold that to private equity. I ended up going to work for another identity company, King Identity, which has a global presence as the head of labs and architecture for King. Lehman went to work in 2012 on this problem, the problem of distributed consensus. And the range of use cases that he wanted to address was far broader than a cryptocurrency. And so if you start with a bar that is much higher in terms of its set of requirements, then the approach has to be fundamentally different. And that's the result of that is the Hashgraph. So what is the Hashgraph? I'm going to describe this in terms of how we are different than the rest of the market of consensus algorithms. And so to do that, we're going to go through several categories of consensus algorithms that exist in the market, and we'll talk about that. And in that context, you'll be able to appreciate the value that Hashgraph brings to the market. So to start, it's not blockchain. It's a fundamentally different approach to solving the problem. It's not a chain at all. It's a graph, as the name implies. It is mathematically proven to have the properties that I will be describing. So it's not ad hoc. Lehman is a mathematician as well as a computer scientist. He started with first principles and the algorithm. There's a white paper on the website. You're welcome to download it. It contains the full description of the algorithm as well as the math proofs that prove out that the algorithm has a set of properties that are important. It is patented, so we are different than the rest of the market in the approach that we're taking to the market. There's some reasons that we're going that route that actually we believe will in fact benefit the market going forward. But it is patented, unlike some of the other products out there, platforms out there. And it's implemented in software. I guess I'll go ahead and just describe that briefly because it's not in the presentation. Our first set of customers are in the financial services industry. Not surprisingly, we competed for the credit union industry beginning about this time last year, and we won that business. And we will be rolling out with the 6,000 credit unions representing 105 million members in the new year. So there is a, if you're familiar with the space at all, R3 is an organization that's creating a platform for the banking industry. The credit union industry wanted to do the same. They called their platform CU Ledger, Credit Union Ledger. That's built on top of us, and that will be our first large-scale deployment coming up in the new year. So now, to talk about the categories. So the market is split into two halves. The public market or public platforms represented by Bitcoin, Ethereum, and others, a whole new crop of public networks that have come out even this year. That's one category. The other category are the permissioned or private networks that are using these open source platforms like Hyperledger and Corda from R3 and EEA and Quorum, etc. That category of product doesn't use blockchain at all, even though sometimes blockchain is generally used as a catch-all term. Distributed ledger technology sometimes is applied to the permissioned network category. This technology, this architecture, is normally what's used on the permission side in the permission network case. It's really simple to understand. Each of these computers here represents a node in the network. So if it were a closed network of banks, hypothetically, permissioned network of banks, each one of these would be a bank running a node in the network. The banks each have a local copy of a database, and the goal is to keep that database in sync. And you have each bank potentially writing independently to its local copy of the database. Somehow, we have to make sure that all the write transactions, if you will, the changes to the local database is appropriately or are appropriately reflected across all of the databases for all the members they have to stay in sync. The way they accomplish this is pretty simple. The software that's running on each of these nodes elects a leader from the set of representatives. And then all of these nodes send all of their transactions to the leader node. The leader node has the responsibility of taking those transactions, putting them in an order, and then sending those transactions in that order back out to every member of the network. Each member then, of course, takes those transactions in that order and applies them to the underlying database. That's how you keep the databases in sync. There are several problems with this architecture, this approach. Number one, there's a leader, and that represents a bottleneck in the architecture. So as a result of this, it's typically the case that these networks won't scale to more than a few dozen nodes, a few dozen members. Additionally, the throughput is limited to about 1,000 transactions per second. If you listen to IBM Hyperledger, they will promote that they can achieve 1,000 transactions per second. Microsoft COCO, same thing, 1,000 transactions per second, EEA, etc. So we're capping out at about 1,000 transactions per second in this architecture. Then there are a couple of other problems that are really interesting and very rarely talked about. If it's the case that any single member of the network is compromised, either through a malicious insider, a disgruntled employee, or a virus or malware, and that attacker can send the IP address of the leader to a botnet, they can direct a DDoS, a distributed denial of service attack, against the leader and effectively shut down communication for the network. What's interesting is that in the event that happens, the members will recognize the fact that the leader is no longer communicating with them. And what will they do? They will elect a new leader. That's the appropriate thing to do. So they'll choose a new leader, but by design, the attacker, whichever one of these nodes is compromised, will be told the IP address of the new leader. Otherwise, they can't talk to the leader. That's the way it works. So what do? They, of course, just send the new IP address to the botnet, and they change the target of the attack. In other words, they follow the leader with the DDoS attack, and they can keep the system down for as long as they keep up the attack. it's also the case that it would be really difficult, if not impossible, to detect which one of these nodes has actually been compromised. All they have to do is transmit a few bytes out of the network, the IP address of the leader, and that's it. So the attacker can do it in anonymity. If a bank decided they wanted to be malicious, hypothetically, they could do so, and the other members of the network wouldn't know which bank has been compromised. It's a really pernicious attack. It's something that you just can't fundamentally address using this architecture. There's another issue that's worth noting, and that is if the use cases depend on the order of transactions flowing into the network, the actual order of the transactions flowing into the network be maintained, to be fair, and you don't want a single party to have the power to influence the order of those transactions for all the members, then you wouldn't use this architecture. Let me give an example. If we, for example, wanted to create a distributed trading platform, a matching platform, where the bids and asks are flowing into the platform, obviously it's a bad idea to give the power to one particular node to dictate the eventual order those transactions are for the entire network. It's possible in that scenario to potentially bribe the node that's dictating the order. Ideally, you don't want any leader involved in this. You want the actual order of the transactions to be maintained by the algorithm without there being the opportunity for one party to influence that order. So it's not fair in that sense. Leader-based systems are not fair in that sense. Next slide, please. So this represents the public platforms, what you all heard about, Bitcoin, Ethereum, more generally, proof of work, blockchain that uses proof of work. And this works pretty simply as well. Each of these racks of computers here represents a miner. And so in this case, we have five miners in the network. All of the transactions flowing into the network, so if you had a wallet on your smartphone, for example, and you want to pay somebody a coin, that transaction would flow to all of the miners in the network. So all the miners collect all of the transactions flowing into the network. Each miner then takes those transactions, puts them into a block of transactions, and they compete then. This is what the proof of work is all about. They each attempt to solve a hard cryptographic puzzle. And the miner that solves that puzzle first earns the right to take their block of transactions and publish it to the other miners. And they get paid, they get compensated for doing so. So if this miner were to solve the puzzle first, it would take the block and send it to the other miners. The other miners would take that block of transactions and put it on top of their chain, their local copy of their chain, the blockchain, and that's how all the chains stay in sync. So it's interesting in that this is DDoS resilient in a way that leader-based systems aren't. It's not possible to predict which miner is going to solve the crypto puzzle. And because of that, you can't do a DDoS attack against the miners. It's too late once the puzzle is solved, right? When it comes to fairness, it's the case that the miners unilaterally, individually, make decisions about which transactions go into the block, if they go in at all. So no miner is required to put all transactions in the block. In fact, by design, it's often the case that a lot of transactions won't go into the block because the block size is limited. So the miners make the decisions about which transactions go into a block. And when they put them in a block, it's up to the miner to decide the order of those transactions within the block. So the miner that wins the competition has dictated the order of transactions that the rest of the network will adopt or come to consensus on. So it's not fair in the same way that we discussed before. It's extremely expensive, as you probably already know. And it's also very slow in terms of throughput or performance. Where the leader-based systems can achieve about 1,000 transactions per second, these systems are two, three, four transactions per second as a matter of practice today. So the market has reacted by attempting to address this proof of work problem with the problem being performance and cost, by coming up with what we call the economy-based approach to consensus. It works something like this. The notion is that, in this case, these are the equivalent of the miners, although they're no longer called miners, they're called stakers. The members of the network, we make the assumption that the members are going to be rational in the sense that they're going to do what's in their own self-interest monetarily. They're going to try and maximize the amount of money that they're going to make by participating as miners. If we make that assumption, then it's possible to create an incentive structure where these stakers are compensated in certain ways that will result in the community coming to an agreement on which blocks should go on top of the chain. It's a little bit complicated about exactly how it works, but exactly how it works doesn't really matter. Because the economy-based solutions have the same problems in some fundamental ways of real economies. One, the assumption that the miners, or the stakers rather, are going to be rational is probably not a good assumption. It's understandable why we would make this assumption, because then it becomes possible to design incentive structures that can drive the market to consensus. But if a node is compromised, say by a virus, well, the virus may not be rational. In fact, the virus may have the sole purpose of acting irrational in order to stop the community from coming to consensus. So the whole fundamental assumption of rationality is not a good assumption to start with. Secondly, in the same way, if I were to ask you, can you prove to me, formally, using math, a math proof, can you prove to me that the stock market is never going to crash again? Well, of course not. That's not possible. And why not? It's not possible because it's an extremely complex system, and it's chaotic. And so it's not possible to formally analyze at a fundamental level the economic system of the stock market and write a math proof that says if you operate it in a certain way, it will guarantee that it will never crash. That's just nonsensical. This is in the same way. It's so complex, these systems are so complex, that they can't be formally analyzed and math proofs written that say even something as simple as this. It's not possible to even say, I have a math proof that proves that even a single attacker can't perform some attack that will result in this network not coming to consensus. Right? It's not possible to do that. It's a really hard problem, right? And so it's understandable why this approach is being taken to address the proof of work problem, but it's kind of ad hoc in the sense that you can't say anything formally about security of the network. Okay. So what's interesting is that if we go back 30 plus years, there's a new category. Excuse me, at that point in time, there was created a new category of algorithm. These are pure voting-based algorithms. They exist in the literature, but nobody really uses them. They work pretty simply. So you have the different nodes in the network. In this case, they're sort of represented by desktop computers. There's no proof of work involved. And the way consensus works is there's a question a yes-no question that is asked to each of the nodes in the network. And each node in the network will cast their vote of their opinion, whether the answer to the question is yes or no. And when they cast that vote, their vote has to be sent to every other node in the network. And any time a node receives a vote, that node has to, in turn, send an acknowledgement back, not just to the node from which the message came, the vote came, but to all of the nodes in the network. In other words, this system bandwidth requirements blows up very quickly. The number of messages that get transmitted throughout the network just grows exponentially fast in terms of the number of nodes in the network. Because of that, there are no systems that are pure voting-based systems that are productized in market today because of the bandwidth requirements. However, what's interesting to know is that the security properties, the theoretical properties of this category of consensus algorithms are fantastic. In fact, they achieve the best security assumption, the best security proofs that one can hope to achieve in the world of distributed consensus. It's something called asynchronous Byzantine fault tolerance. And what it means is that we can assume an extremely strong attacker, an attacker that is strong enough that they can shut down the internet. And as long as eventually a message can flow from one node to the next, then the community will come to consensus on the order of transactions with 100% probability. I mean, the community will understand with 100% certainty, I should say, the order of those transactions, and they will also know that that order will never change. In other words, it's not probabilistic like blockchain, if you understand my meaning. The blockchain, with each new block you put on top of the chain, the probability that the order of transactions will change goes down. It grows asymptotic to the number of blocks on top of the chain. In this case, there are no probabilities. The community will come to agreement with 100% certainty on the order of transactions, and that the order is certain that it will never change. So it achieves the very best security that's possible, but it's not practical. So how do we solve the problem? How do we create a consensus algorithm that is asynchronous Byzantine fault tolerant, but is also efficient in terms of bandwidth usage? That's what Hashgraph does. So Hashgraph is an approach, innovation that is a fundamental advance in the world of distributed consensus. For the very first time, it's now possible practically at scale to have an algorithm that is asynchronous Byzantine fault tolerant. So the way this works is each node in the network is running a local copy of a database. As I mentioned previously, this is sort of the idea in all of these systems. You want to have a replicated database, and the database needs to stay in sync across all the nodes. If that's the case, then when any given node wants to write a transaction to their database, that transaction has to go to all of the nodes in the network. So all transactions, all write transactions, have to go to all the nodes in the network. That's the minimum bandwidth that is required. You can't do better than that if you have a replicated database. It turns out that if we add a tiny amount of information on top of that, so if this were Alice and this is Bob, and Alice is going to send to Bob a transaction, when Alice does so, she adds two hashes. So if you know about cryptography, that would be meaningful. If you don't know about cryptography, what that means is it's a tiny amount of information, a trivial amount of information on top of the transaction. So Alice will send to Bob her transaction, and she will send two hashes, and this information represents, conceptually, who Alice last spoke with. So each node, when it sends the transaction to the next node, it at the same time tells the next node who they just previously spoke to. And by doing that, each node is able to take all of that metadata, all of that gossip information, if you want to call it that, and build up an internal representation, a graph, that describes the communication flow across all the nodes in the network. In other words, we have this picture, literally a picture in memory, in RAM, that describes who has spoken to whom and when. We then take, and by the way, every node is going to have the same picture. Just as these nodes talk to each other, they're building up this picture of who has talked to whom and when over time. The graph grows uphill with time. And each node will have exactly the same picture, provably. That's what the hashes are for. And we then take a pure voting-based algorithm, and every node is using the same pure voting-based algorithm, and each node uses their hash graph as an input to the voting-based algorithm. And so for a particular vote, if we need to ask the question, a yes-no question that helps us put the transactions in order, we simply use the information in hash graph to calculate for each member of the network what they would have voted if they were to have cast their vote over the network. But they don't have to do it. They don't have to send the information over the network. And because we all are using the same hash graph, the same pure voting based algorithm, and each node is doing the same calculation, we all come up with the same answer. In other words, we have consensus. We have asynchronous Byzantine fault tolerant distributed consensus, and we achieve the bandwidth limit. I don't know how you do any better than two hashes. You have to send all the transactions. We have two hashes of information on top, and it's asynchronous Byzantine fault tolerant, which is the theoretically best possible security you have in this category. You're done. So what I'm going to say is a fairly bold statement, and I recognize that, but I'm going to make the claim that what Lehman has done is solved the problem of distributed consensus, and that 100 years from now, there may be dozens of variants on the hashgraph algorithm, but they will be on the hashgraph algorithm, not a leader-based system, not an autonomy-based system, certainly not proof of work, right? This is the solution to distributed consensus. Okay, so what does that mean? It means that we can do a whole lot of things that previously were not possible. The throughput on this solution is fantastic. It's orders of magnitude faster than the best competition, the next best competitor. And because there's no proof of work, you know, I had notebook computers up there representing the nodes. You literally can use notebook computers. You could, when we do our testing of the software, we're running this on Raspberry Pis, a rack of Raspberry Pis. So you could put it on a smartphone. Each smartphone could be a node in the network. If we had a public ledger with cryptocurrency, then the public ledger would be able to do micropayments natively. No need for side chains or any other mechanism that's on the side to process lots of transactions at really low cost and then get settled to a public chain. This could do micropayments natively because the cost is de minimis, right? It's literally almost zero. If we were doing a game like World of Warcraft, for example, in that case, you would build a game on top of this world's platform, this world's SDK, And each member of the community wants to play this game and compete in this virtual world against each other would simply download the software to their notebook computer, fire it up. You'd have a full peer-to-peer mesh of players all sharing the same state in this virtual world. When I take a step in a direction or I pull my bow, those are transactions that get gossiped to all the other nodes. All the other nodes stay in sync in near real time, really low latency, and you can have this game without the need for a central server. That is fair. And fairness is really important, by the way, when it comes to games. Who actually pulled the trigger first on the gun makes a big difference, right? So, in other words, we can do things with this technology that for the first time are possible, and it moves us in the direction of actually changing the face of the internet in some fundamental ways. This in some ways is sort of the anti-cloud, where if the cloud by definition is sort of client-server, where there's a central server, Google is running Google Docs, and you're collaborating in the business apps, five people are working together to create a document, Google's in the middle, right? If you're in an auction with eBay is managing the auction, they control policies and make sure that it's secure and people can't cheat, eBay is in the middle, right? You pick your SaaS provider, they're in the middle and you have to trust them. This makes it possible for the first time for a much, much broader range of SaaS applications to disintermediate the SaaS and go entirely peer-to-peer and not have to trust that central party. Okay. Okay. So that was it. And now I think you're going to hear a lot more, and I'm going to leave it to you.
Hi, my name is Calvin, and I'm here to share with you what I've learned about Hashgraph for the past week. Hashgraph is completely new to me. I'm a director of talent networking here with SG Novit, and my job is to look for technical talent. And myself, I'm also a generalist engineer for the past decade, building everything from ultra-low temperature freezers to a brain mapping app for University of Southern California. So that's been what I've been doing over the past decade. More recently, I've been helping SG Novit to look for technical talent, and I've been messing around with Ethereum and cryptocurrency, obviously, and I came across Hashgraph. And when I started reading more into Hashgraph, I realized that it has fundamentally changed how blockchain and Ethereum is treating the problem, which is why I was very excited to get in touch with SOSD and Edgar to run this event. So here in this short presentation, I hope, I'll share with you what I've learned in Hashgraph. I'm not an expert by any means, but I'm very happy to share with you what I've learned and how we can all change the world together. So I'm going to start with a bit of a geek joke. If you're not in computer science, pardon me. Right? A short history of computer science. There are only two hard problems in computer science. And the answer, of course, is that cache invalidation, naming things, and off by one errors. Not funny. Okay, so we have computer science and we have distributed systems, which is what we're talking about today. And why are we interested in distributed systems? Because it is actually the foundation for cloud computing. It is because cloud computing is dealing with increasing large amount of data set that we want to have many, many nodes out there replicating this data, providing us with low latency to handle this data. Right, but existing blockchain and Ethereum methods have their limitations, and we are looking for solutions to solve the problem of scaling up massive amount of data, massive amount of machines, all of a machine economy, so to speak. So now that we know a little bit about distributed systems, which Man-Saman has shared with us earlier on, I'll follow on with a second funny joke about distributed systems. There are only two hard problems in distributed systems. What are they? Anyone? No? No one? Nobody here is from comp science? Seriously? I'm not from comp science, by the way. So, the joke about distributed systems is this. It is very difficult to achieve the following. So, as explained by Man-Saman, we have different ways of solving the distributed systems problem, and one of the ways which Man-Saman is claiming is the best way to solve the distributed system. And so, if we take a little step back, what is this problem about distributed systems? So, those of you who are not in comp science, I'll just indulge me to describe this. It is to solve the Byzantine fault tolerance problem. And this came from an allegory of this little story over here. Right? Imagine that in a city, there are many divisions of the army that are camped outside the enemy. They have to plot a plan of attack to come to a consensus on when to attack and where to attack. Right? Their transactions, so to speak. So they need an algorithm to guarantee that all the loyal generals in this Byzantine army will attack together, and their consensus is secure. That even if they have traitors within their midst, or as Man-Saman pointed out earlier, if one of the nodes is infected by viruses, the majority of the generals will still know what to do, how to do the right thing. So this is essentially covered by Man-Saman as a summary of what he has just said. There are leader-based systems, there are proof-of-work systems, there are proof-of-stake systems or economy-based systems, and there are voting-based systems where there are no practical examples of that being used in the wild. And of course, finally, we have the virtual voting system, or as Man's call it, the ultimate solution. So this is a summary. And if we drill down further at a lower level, which is where I'm going. The reason why I'm summarizing this is because I want to drill down into the code. So for the developers in the midst, you will begin to associate between the high-level ideas so described to the low-level code and modules and packages that I'm going to show you soon. Right, so we zoom down a bit and we start to understand that blockchain data is stored in blocks, while hashgraph data is stored in events. The data structure is completely different, with blockchain needing consensus of who has the right to add a block through a proof of work. Hashgraph, on the other hand, stores this data as a graph of connections, a gossip graph that shows who has last talked to who. And finally, the protocol is completely different, one taking a POW approach and one taking a virtual voting approach. So, we drill down further into virtual voting. Now imagine that the hash graph is divided into rounds, as you will see later in actual code. Every time that one event can connect to two-thirds of the first events of current round by blah blah blah, it's actually quite powerful, by more paths than two-thirds of the population, we will claim that one node strongly sees another node. Next, the second step is actually a three-step process. This is the first step. The second step is that we need to agree that the data contained in the first four events are agreed upon. To do so, they just need to know that they're connected to those nodes. And finally, in the last stage, right, is to collect all the third round node answers. Every round, first round, second round, third round. The fourth round nodes must strongly see the third round node. And the definition of strongly see is, as described in item 1 earlier. If one of the fourth round nodes succeeds in collecting a supermajority, then the consensus is found. So, this three steps I described in a bit of a confusing English language needs to be implemented in code. Okay, that's done by SourceD's SDK, which some parts are closed source, but we have a comparable open source version which I'll share with you later, with no guarantees that the open source code is actually entirely accurate. Okay, so this is the three pieces of logic that needs to be implemented. So I'll cover this in code. So as a design in this viewpoint, right, the first point being that we're going to show you in diagram form what has happened earlier on. Okay? And then after that, I'm going to run a couple of SWSD demos on my machine and show you how the code has been laid out and how you can add in your own custom logic. And finally, the open source version is called Babel. It is not actually an official version by SWSD. It's done by a third party developer who made his source code open source. It's implemented in Golang and it's available on GitHub. No guarantees that it's the actual correct copy. Mess around with it because it's open source. So once you download the SDK from SWSD's website and you open it up, the few key concepts that you need to understand are the following. Right? The first one is SWL main, which you want to learn and extend from. The next is a state, which is essentially the state of the hash graph at any point in time. And finally, the platform itself. And fastcopier is a way to persist data as seen in the file system demo example later on. And finally, there's two other utility classes, which is called browser console for visualization purposes. So if you are a Java developer, you will understand all this as simply Java classes. In diagram form, we will actually visualize it this way. Okay, still not very clear. I'll zoom into the code very soon. Essentially, we organize it. In my mind, I organize it in this manner, right? Not the official SWSD recommendation, but this is how I think about things in my mind as I read through the documentation. And if you open up the SDK, of course, there's a Java docs which will show in detail exactly what each of the classes do. I'll jump on to show you an Eclipse setup and an IntelliJ setup. Eclipse is the recommended setup by SWSD SDK, but personally, I can't make head or tail of Eclipse. I don't use Eclipse at all. I use IntelliJ, so I will provide a corresponding IntelliJ setup, and I have an open source template, project template, for you to start running with IntelliJ. So these are the five key demos that I'll be walking through. Before you do anything, the first thing that you need to know is that if you're using Mac OS, you need to make sure, not just Mac OS really, any machine, any operating system, you need to be sure that you're using the latest JDK 8. So if you try running it on JDK 9, essentially the app will not run, not at this point. So right now, the SDK only supports JDK 8. So if I set it up on Eclipse, the layout will essentially look like this. I will open it up on my computer if you want to show you, but just scan through this. And the corresponding IntelliJ setup will look something like this, with the requirement that you will set your own execution path for this SDK jar file, and you will start running it in any directory that you prefer. You'll see that in a while. Fundamentally, whether you're using IntelliJ or whether you're using Eclipse or whether you're using Vim or you're running it from command line, all you need to know really is that at the end of the day, to run the app, you would execute this command. In fact, when we set things up this way in IntelliJ, we are actually running exactly this command. The next thing that you need to know as a developer is that messing around with the SDK is that there is a config.txt file which the swls.jar file, right, will actually scan through and determine that which of this demo apps are going to be the one that's running. Obviously, you will have to compile your Java source code into a jar first before you can run it. I'm sorry if I'm going through this and some of you are not developers because it will take just too much time to explain it to you if you're not a developer. So I assume some basic knowledge on how to use an IDE. And finally, the setup will look something like this. And this is the default layout if you're using official Swiss SDK. Now, once you're familiar with the setup, which I'll show you in a bit, you can also choose to use a very clean setup that I've made publicly available. You can just clone this, remove the .git, and start running, adding your own code. Right? This is a clean setup without any of the demo apps. And you can essentially run them as two separate projects, one project with all the demo apps that you can refer to, and a pure clean setup that you can write your own custom code on and start building your custom logic. So that's the two setup that I have to show you. Okay? So I'm going to put down my mic now, and I'm going to be a bit. I'm going to show you visually how it works.
Part of the SDK. over here. The first project was this one that I showed you. The second project is actually Hello Solidity Demo, with the source code being here. And as you can see, same pattern. You essentially implement Solidity, and you implement Solidity. And of course, you can browse the structure itself to understand what is happening here, including some of the native data structure that is built into the SDK, such as, for example, So, even though it is closed source, well, you can still browse some items over here. Like, if you decompose it, then you can look at some source code here to understand what's happening. Okay, so that's our couple of demos. The next demo that you can actually mess around with is the game demo. The screenshot is over here. At TechCrunch Disrupt recently, a team actually built a kitten catch game, where you have to play as a... It's very similar to this game, where you have four players, that is Bob, Carol, and Dan, and you're trying to see who is the fastest to catch certain items, which in this case is this round little circle over here. And finally, there's a hashgraph demo itself to show you that to render visually how the hashgraph is. So we can run the demo, we can uncomment the config.txt file, which is really straightforward, and you can run the different apps and see it for yourself. And this out again, if you want to mess around with the game demo, this is it. And you can browse over to our game demo source code, look in here, and same thing, same pattern, with all the specific implementation here. In the case of a game demo, the console actually detects key presses by the end user on the interface. So this is a GUI key listener class that you can implement. Send some of the classes here. You can detect what happens, you can decide, you can write logic to decide what happens when the user presses the space bar. So it's essentially a game there. So if we run that, having uncommented this particular item, if I run this now, it will show us the game there. It will stop the previous.
After reading through the Golang code, which is written mostly by this
extremely talented programmer called Martin Herbert. He's based in the UK. I was corresponding with him over email as well. Very interesting learning perspective. I would visualize the comparison between the two source code in this manner. That will save you some time trying to understand what Martin did and how it compares with what we just covered, which is the Java implementation. In any case, the fundamental principle is it uses a hash graph call and essentially goes through a network transport to share the state of the hash graph with every node in the network. For the Go-like implementation, they actually use the Docker implementation to run a testnet, and within this Docker network, if you're familiar with what Docker is, all the nodes will be able to exchange information with each other. So that makes things really convenient for testing purposes. I love Go-like. Docker is written in Go. And this is an overview of what I understand from Martin's work. It is a slightly more decoupled architecture to facilitate language agnostic implementation. What that really means is that you can write whatever you want in front of here, in front of the app, to write your own custom logic in a separate language and essentially use a JSON RPC transform or HTTP API or whatever you want, or even a WebSocket implementation to directly communicate with this. Right, so it's a decoupled architecture, and the entire source code is very well tested. Lots of good tests for you. So that's how they have structured it. Which, so there's an example implementation in it as well. And as I mentioned, it uses Docker to run the testnet. And there's a simple chat demo on it. So you can actually chat with each other without the server. So finally, if you're familiar with HashiCorp's tooling, this source code also implements a Terraform specification, which allows you to easily deploy on AWS. Which, if you don't like AWS, you can also deploy on GCP. So that's the Ava source code. And there's a series of big files in it, which you can run commands to test it. So very well tested, lots of tests in it. To do with more coverage, but hey, this is a good start. And if I open it up in IntelliJ, so one more caveat is that for the latest version of IntelliJ, if you're familiar with it, it requires you to buy a license. I'm using a slightly older version, I refuse to upgrade because it requires you to buy a license. So the newer version requires you to buy a license if you're running a license. It has its own stats implementation, which I made a contribution to his source code. I implemented a Docker file to run the stats in this way, so that whether you're running on macOS or whether you're running on Linux, you'll be able to see the stats. So, of course, this is not as polished as the stats that the official source code is. Essentially, you get similar information that you know how how many transactions is happening, how many rounds is happening in the hash graph, etc. And if you run the demo app itself, the slash demo directory, run this command make demo, it's all in the big file. No secret there. Once you run it, you can actually see that it spins up four windows. If you are on Ubuntu, it would be rendering an X11 window. If you are on Mac, this will be text box window. So you'll be able to write a chat message here from client 1, and client 2 will be able to get exactly the chat message. So this is a distributed chat application. And if we dive further down into the code, this is what Martin wrote. It's the Golang implementation of the Java hash graph. It's all there, so you can look at it yourself. I took a screenshot so that in case IntelliJ hangs up like it did, I'll still show you. And of course, the network implementation is here. So all these packages actually correspond So I'll move on to the implications. Before we talk about cryptocurrencies, which I know everybody wants to talk about that, nobody wants to talk about the code in it. Yes. So the implications of Hashgraph is this, right?
It's a general purpose. You can build Hashgraph as a general purpose distributed network, right? For example, Ethereum is a good comparison. Or you can build a specific purpose Hashgraph and implement it in very specific use cases, right? And there's an interesting article written by this guy called David Allen Cohen, a very famous guy in the distributed systems world and AI world, right? He says that Hashgraph is in fact what he's looking for. There's a missing gap in autonomous AI systems that he builds. Or, of course, you can implement it as a consortium solution for banks. Maybe even challenge Swift, I don't know. So that's the guy I'm talking about, right? The article is there. For those of you who are taking photos, there's actually no need for you to do so. I'll be publicly sharing my slide deck, and the link will be shared with everybody. So he mentioned this, right? That is your IOTA question, which is why I skipped. So he answers it, don't ask me to code on it because I don't mess around with IOTA. Right, some buzzwords here to complete the picture. Right? The whole idea of using Hashgraph to tie AI systems together allows us to achieve, well, Skynet. Okay, so these are some fun tech projects that you might be interested, the developers in the crowd here might be interested to mess around with. I am particularly interested in Hashgraph in Android. For the fourth item, Hashgraph on Raspberry Pi, actually, as Mans mentioned, they actually have a rack of Raspberry Pi where they run Hashgraph on it. If you look in the official docs, there's also installation instructions for specifically Raspbian. So here are some interesting questions I have, right? Just to set the stage for the Q&A now, right? Interesting questions that I don't have answers to, but I want to ask. And here are some interesting, impactful applications that, hey, maybe some of you out there could build, right? Decentralized learning for medical data sharing without having a central server which runs the risk of compromising everybody's data if security is breached on that central server. Right? It could be used for peer-to-peer coordination, it could be used for service transformation. Like, you know, if you just want to move out from your country and look for work in another country, you have to fill in so many forms in your home country, then when you arrive at your destination country, there's a whole bunch of forms to repeat again. Right? What a pain, right? There are many ways of using a consortium layer, using Hashgraph, to solve this problem. Right now, the best solution is APIs, right? You communicate between APIs. But imagine the amount of work needing to talk to 50 organizations. That's crazy amount of APIs that you interact with. But if everybody, the consortium comes together and agree on using Hashgraph, there's only one set of APIs. And of course, the last one is very interesting to most people. Okay, here's an interesting article that I came across just a couple of weeks ago, probably. Yeah, 3rd of December, is that right? Yeah. So MOH to compel private doctors to submit info for national healthcare database. Seriously, I bet they're using APIs. Just saying. I shouldn't complain too much because one of our board members, as you know it, is involved in MOH. How about port systems, for example, beyond landing? Right? So I want to go back a little bit in history of Singapore. Right? What is interesting is that this Dr. Goh Keng Swee, one of the pioneers of Singapore, he was the one who pushed for containerization of Singapore's port way before containerization was the standard thing. Now we take it for granted that we have these huge container ships, we have this huge port list and pools, which is standardized across all the ports in the world. Now, We are in a very different age where information is everywhere and the ways in which we interact with how we extract information is non-standardized, confusing, and all over the place. So the question I would ask myself is Hashgraph a way to standardize information sharing? Just like container ports was the way to standardize logistics 30 years ago. Right? It's an interesting question I had in my mind. And of course, impactful applications. I'm sure some of you might have bought a $100,000 crypto kitty over the weekend. This is the hot topic this weekend. Okay, now I'll open up the Q&A, but advertisement. So SGNovate has a deep tech nexus strategy. SGNovate is a government-backed investor. We invest in deep tech startups, medtech startups, and we have built-in teams that help our portfolio companies look for market opportunities. We also take care of talent spotting for our portfolio companies. So if you are a startup founder, scientist, you want to build a future with us, or if you are already running a startup, we're glad to know that we have this upcoming apprenticeship program where we pick some of the top technical talents from universities in Singapore and pair them up with deep tech startups and run a mentorship program with a senior engineer pairing up with an up-and-coming strong technical student. And of course, if you're a talent here and you're looking for interesting opportunities in our current portfolio company, there's the link at the bottom here. Right, just key in your phone and key in your phone number and get in touch with us. Right, it's a very simple URL once you get in. Key in your phone number and we'll get in touch with you. So advertisement over.
Thank you, Calvin. That was very helpful. So now we're going to have Mance, Jordan Freed, who runs business development for Swirls, and myself, and Calvin can join us, and we'll just sit up here and we'll open it up for any questions.
the details of the algorithm have been on the website published for about 18 months, about a year and a half. Lehman has presented the algorithm at Berkeley, at, I forget the name of the conference, but it was a conference of the academics that do research in the industry. So it was a peer level conference at the algorithm level. It's also the case that Lehman is preparing a manuscript for VLDB, and it will be presented, and presuming they accept it, it would be presented for peer review at VLDB. And then we've also considered, I think there is a journal that's out of Cornell, a relatively new journal for the space that's out of Cornell, that will be presented to, or submitted to, for peer review as well. So what I can tell you is that a lot of academics have looked at it informally and provided some feedback. Nobody has said there's a fundamental flaw in the logic. I mean, it's really a pretty simple concept. If you understand that you can use gossip about gossip to build this internal data structure, and then you just use that as an input to a pure voting-based algorithm, that's it. It is. That is what was surprising, the whole gossip about gossip innovation. Why hasn't it been discovered before? So the reason, so why haven't we submitted it to VLDB so far? Well, several reasons. One, we sort of expect this to be a seminal paper, right? One that is going to be used in reference by many, many, many researchers. And so Lehman is taking his time to not only present the detailed information that is associated, what's in the white paper, but also to develop a full set of formal performance results. And getting performance results requires basically finishing the code base. And so that has been the bottleneck. The completion of the formal testing results at scale in a globally distributed network, all of that can be included in this paper that is ultimately submitted for. It's there in the white paper. Yeah, I mean, that's there today, that's been there. So your point is well taken. The only bottleneck has been finishing the code base, getting the performance results, including that in what we hope will become an important paper for the community. Yes?
Well,
I'll go with
the financial services and identity and customer anonymity are very, very important. Do you think regulators and governments are going to start clamping down more because more kind of so why do they hash rock in terms of the industry and where to be?
So I think that, so two things. From a pure security perspective, I don't think that regulators, or many people, period, understand the security implications of the DLTs that are in the market. And so I think that there will be an increasing awareness of the pros and cons of the different categories of consensus algorithms as it relates to their security properties. I know that for a fact, right? I'm very familiar with security organizations, security consultancies, global consultancies, that are working on white papers that will educate the market in this regard. And on the identity side of this, it's interesting because there are two things. When you take this technology and you basically have a database that has been managed by single entity, and now for the first time you have this multi-master database where each master is being run by a different legal entity, a whole set of security concerns arise, as well as key management issues when we come to privacy, data privacy, PII, and all this. So I think a new layer of identity that specifically is focused on distributed key management as opposed to standard key management will emerge, and it will be complementary to this architecture. And so distributed key management as a category will emerge. And then obviously this whole self-sovereign identity movement has been around for a long time, and it's found a vehicle in distributed architectures like this to achieve some of the goals. And so a lot of people now are hearing about self-sovereign identity for the first time. It's actually not new. It goes back a long ways. And some of the founders of, for example, the Sovereign Foundation, which is a nonprofit that is taking to market through NGOs and commercial entities the creation of a global distributed identity network that helps to achieve self-sovereign identity. Those guys are what we, from the identity world, call identirati. They're the experts that go back 15 years that have been in the identity space that long, as opposed to some of the other players in the market that really don't have an identity background but understand that there are important identity implications with this technology. So yes, identity, I think, will be affected fundamentally, and the market over time will become more mature and understand the security and identity implications of the technology. What will that mean for the regulators? I think it will make the regulators' job easier, because now the regulators are putting in controls under the assumption that there are trusted third parties that might do bad things and they need to therefore be regulated. And that model is what we're changing, and we're making it possible for the regulators to operate a node in this distributed network so that they have transparency into everything that's going on, but they don't have to prevent a single third party from doing bad things. They trust the community. As long as not more than a third of the members of the community are colluding, then these same bad things can't be done. So it will make their life easier in some ways.
So I have some technology questions. So the first one is, what exactly are we storing in the cloud? What are we querying? Is it timestamp, order timestamp to the hash, or what else is there? And the other question is, what exactly is storing? Because I can imagine that with 100,000 million nodes, what fraction of the data everything is installed on, say, somewhere in the network?
So, this goes back to, how do you scale the system? And the system will be scaled in a sharded way, meaning that a given shard probably is not going to have fewer than 100 nodes within it, and also probably not more than 1,000. Practically speaking, probably won't be more than 1,000. In any given application, you have to decide what your data architecture is going to look like. At the application layer has a database, if you wanted to call it that, or a data store more generally. And this data store stores the state of the application. If we're talking about a cryptocurrency as an example, the state of the cryptocurrency would be the list of all the wallets, active wallets in the universe, and their balances. That would be the state of the cryptocurrency application. So there's a state object, and then there is a main object. You saw the two in our examples here. The main object is the business logic that creates transactions that get submitted to the network. When those transactions, a transaction in this case might be Alice pays Bob a coin. When that transaction is submitted to the platform has responsibility for ensuring that this transaction flows through all the different nodes, all the transactions are put into an order, and then transactions are fed back up to the application. And the application takes those transactions in consensus order and updates the state object appropriately. So it will decrement Alice's wallet and increment Bob's wallet. And of course, do some validation, make sure that's the right thing to do.
But, so you're saying that state is gone, however, there's also going to be a record of history. So
yes.
That sounds like a lot of data.
actually it's not. So it's important to understand that there is a state object. On a regular basis, the community, say at a point in time, on a regular basis, time t equals a billion, the community comes to consensus on the state object. So the community comes to consensus on the values for all the wallets. What are the active wallets and what are their values? Once the community comes to consensus on the state object, then all of the transactions that have already been applied to the state object can be thrown away because their effect is represented in the state object, and there's a community signed state object. So from that point forward, you have the transactions flowing around in the hash graph, building up and putting them in order, and you update the state object again. And then you have another point in time where you come again to agreement on the signed state at that moment in time, and you prune the hash graph from all the transactions prior to that point in time. If you had a new node come into the network, when they connect to the network, they just choose a node, another node in the network, and they say, please give me the latest community signed state. Download the latest community signed state, they begin to gossip in the network, they build up their hash graph, they apply the transactions to their local copy of the signed state, and the cycle repeats. And so using the signed state process, we're able to continually prune the hash graph so that it's not like blockchain where you have to keep all the transactions back to the genesis block.
So it's not really distributed ledger technology, it's another consensus of one that might run.
I understand when you say ledger, you mean a ledger that grows infinitely long.
So I say that you guys are telling us that it's not a ledger, it's actually a consensus algorithm.
That's correct. That's incorrect. It's a consensus algorithm. The platform itself, what you can download in the SDK, the platform itself is a consensus algorithm and a communications protocol. So it makes it possible for all the nodes to talk to one another very efficiently using the gossip protocol. It takes the transactions, puts them in an order, and then passes those transactions in consensus order back up to the application. If you wanted to create a distributed ledger, you're correct, you would do that at the application layer.
Yep.
What we have is a consensus server. That's how I view it. In the same way, every company in the world today has a web server that serves up arbitrary web applications, I believe there will be a consensus server sitting next to it that serves up arbitrarily complex distributed applications. And so I think it's important, this is an important point. When Bitcoin was introduced, you look at the code base, it's all one big monolithic thing that is a distributed cryptocurrency. I think what will happen increasingly is that the components of that solution will become more and more differentiated. And that's what we've done. We have created an architecture that starts with a communications layer and a consensus layer, and then on top of that, you would build an application which would be a cryptocurrency, and maybe included in that is the logic for doing validation, and also the distributed ledger itself, if you will. But these pieces of the stack are going to be split apart and differentiated, and there will be other, for example, if we're talking about smart contracts, okay? The Ethereum VM has the potential of becoming sort of the standard component in this stack for smart contracts, right? And it's perfectly legitimate to take that and put it on top of our consensus server and achieve the benefits. So I think you'll see differentiation in the stack.
One more question. It's a more of an application question now. So how do people go about building applications where some data is private, for example, health data? Somebody wants data to be safe, but he doesn't want people to be.
Yeah, exactly. So this goes back to the question of distributed key management. right? So identity as a layer does need to be added. And when I say distributed key management, the notion is that you want some parts of the data. So we're talking about healthcare. You want the patient to be able to specify who can see their records, and you have a node in a hospital, and a node in a clinic, and a node in a doctor's office. And each of these nodes is encrypting information and storing it in the shared database, but the patient also has a key that can decrypt the information. The patient can have a portal that sees all of it, and also then specifies for any given record which members of the community can see it. Well, this is just a key management problem. So there needs to be a distributed key management layer that's added on top of this to address the issue that you're describing. Other questions? Through the competitors. It depends on, so Swirls is focused on the enterprise use case. And it's not really the case in the enterprise world that we view ourselves as having many competitors. With the credit unions, we competed with Microledger and IBM, and we won that business against them. And the credit union industry took our platform, our consensus server, and built an entire layer of logic on top of that. Similar to what R3 is doing. You know, R3 has Corda, and Corda has a consensus mechanism built into it. I think it's Raft, or maybe PBFT, or both, you can choose. But then on top of the consensus mechanism, they have a whole layer of business logic that's meant to make it easy for developers to build applications for the financial services industry. In our case, we're not competing with Corda. What we would provide is a plug-in, if you will, for the consensus mechanism. And so the permission platform code bases out there, like Hyperledger, EEA, all of them, make their consensus mechanism pluggable. And what we will provide are the plugins. So for customers that have already built apps on top of those platforms, and they shelve the POC because it's not going to scale because of throughput constraints, or they care about security, then they'll be able to take it off the shelf, put our plugin in place of the existing algorithm, and again test it to see if it will achieve scale.
When do you see this coming?
Pluggable. So it depends on the needs of customers, and so what we have been looking for is a customer that wants the plug-in. I think we found it, and so platform by platform, we will add the plug-ins as the customer demand requires.
I just wanted to add something. I think the gentleman in the blue shirt, you asked about adoption. Was the second part of your question. So I think Calvin mentioned we did take the SDK to TechCrunch Hackathon, and we're having an increasingly large number of conversations with some of the largest companies in the world, many of which are actually here in Singapore, which is why we're here, about building private permission-based networks on our consensus mechanism. A lot of those are some of them are self-sovereign identity type applications. Some of them are from startups that have raised funds, frankly, with an ERC-20 token and are realizing they can't execute on the vision and their white paper in a scalable way. And they need a way to build their application and deliver on their vision, or they're going to be in trouble with the regulators, right? So, yeah, we have another. We're going to tokenize the technology. Not in the way that I think you're probably have grown accustomed to the market doing it. We are a company that's been bootstrapped from the beginning, where technology has always been first. as Mance mentioned in his presentation, we had an equity round of fundraising from NDA, and the focus has always been to gain adoption on the enterprise side, to get this deployed in a private permission-based environment. I'm not going to speak to the cryptocurrency aspect right now.
So no crypto kitties.
We like kitties, though.
Have a third of the actors being evil, as long as they don't talk to each other, then we're Byzantine fault tolerant. But they're evil. They're going to talk to each other. They're going to collude. And then another one might be, as long as botnets don't exist, then you're Byzantine fault tolerant. In other words, if you assume that you're never going to be attacked with a DDoS attack, then you're Byzantine fault tolerant. So the assumptions that go into partially synchronous or partially asynchronous BFT just aren't real world assumptions. That's why the whole asynchronous piece of this, that prefix or that qualifier is so important.
How about the security vulnerabilities?
Security vulnerabilities.
Yes.
Well, so there's the algorithm, right? At the algorithmic level, the theory level, you can't do better than an asynchronous BFT. Of course, then there's the implementation. And it's a new code base. So if anybody wanted to complain about swirls, that's a legitimate complaint. Is that it's a new code base. Version 1 is not yet released. And so, you know, there's a lot of course, there's a lot of thought and care going into the implementation. And there will be third parties that do thorough code reviews, etc. And it's very likely the case, just to be clear about this, that the code base itself, at some appropriate point in time, will be open for review. So there is a distinction that I think was appropriately made between open source and open license, right? And so there's a strong argument to be made that it will be open source in the sense that you can propose changes to the code and the code will be open for public review, et cetera, et cetera. But the licensing piece of this is a separate or orthogonal issue. So there's an actual theorem that if one third plus one of the nodes is corrupt, there's nothing you can do. They can keep the community from coming to consensus on the order of transactions, and there will never be a better solution than that for any algorithm, including Bitcoin. And, you know, you hear a lot about this 51% rule. It's actually not well stated. It's the case that if you were to partition blockchain, proof-of-work blockchain, into two parts, then you can have less than 51% of the total population actually causing one of the partitions to come to a conclusion that is not appropriate for the population as a whole. So this whole 51% thing is kind of meaningless. If more than a third are corrupted or evil, and they collude, then they can prevent the community from coming to consensus.
This is kind of...
But it's an improvement over one being evil.
Yeah. So is there any way by
which we can avoid? No. That's the theorem. The theorem that I was referencing says you'll never do better than that. It's not possible mathematically.
I mean, you're kind of already in a position in our code, so you know, it's easy to make it fast, secure, and all that stuff. But I think what we need to do is actually, you know, move to a permissionless environment. How are you going to stay fast, fair?
This is an important point. I'm glad you raised the issue. What you will see often in the press are these algorithms claiming to do millions of transactions per second. Nobody does millions of transactions per second in a single shard. Right? So a shard is a network of fully interconnected nodes. And it is distributed. So let me restate. Nobody does millions of transactions per second in a distributed network that is a shard. Now, if you have a side chain and you connect two parties, and those two parties are talking to each other, and they're doing their own transactions, and they do a million transactions a second, and then they settle at the end of the day by writing to the distributed network, that doesn't count. That's not real. It's not a distributed network. In a distributed network, where all the nodes are fully interconnected, peer-to-peer mesh, then it's important to, for each of the platforms to compare their performance in that network, in that single shard. And what we can say is that blockchain and others, proof of work blockchain and others, you know, they will perform at a certain throughput and latency. And if we compare apples to apples, then we're claiming to be the fastest in the market when comparing apples to apples for a single shard. When if you have a shard of 10 nodes and you have 100,000 shards, then you can do a million transactions per second. But you can't always take advantage of that. Sometimes, depending on the application, you won't be able to scale it beyond a single shard. And in those situations, what matters is what's the throughput in a single shard. And so if you can do 100,000 transactions per second in a single shard versus 10 in a single shard, you're still orders of magnitude faster than everything else. That's the important thing. Consistency notion. So let me just say how we work. The transactions are gossiped into the network, and you know, as fast as you can gossip them into the network. It takes a little while for those transactions to be put in an order. At the application layer, you can ask for the transactions to be relayed to you or shown to you as they come in, even prior to coming to consensus. And so at the application layer, you do sort of a base read using database terminology. You can do a base read versus an ACID read. And so a good example might be if you log into a website that has hotel rooms to sell. When you render that page, you don't need to know the exact inventory, so you just use the latest information even though it's not in consensus order, and you throw that up on the website that says I have 38 rooms left to sell. When you get ready to push the buy now button, it really matters how many rooms are left. Then you do an ACID read, if you want to use that term, which means that it is in consensus order. And so you have the option at the application layer to use either, because all the transactions are flowing in real time, and the system tells you whether they're in consensus order or not. There are two issues. One is, how large is the state versus how large is a transaction? And so you're right, if you have a state that is many terabytes, then when you...
I say gigabytes, not terabytes. We're not pretty easy.
Okay, all right, so gigabytes. Well, I was thinking of Wikipedia, actually. I was thinking, how do you disintermediate you don't want to disintermediate Wikipedia, but you don't want them to have to use servers anymore, right? In that case, it's terabytes, like something like 17 terabytes, something like that. You got a problem there, right? I mean, you can stand up multiple nodes, but you have to have a database that, I mean, enough storage to hold everything that's in Wiki. So when you have a new node coming online, they have to somehow get the state, the database. That's one problem that you have to deal with. is really big size. And then separate from that is what is the size of the transaction. If it's a cryptocurrency, then you can actually do a whole crypto transaction in about 100 bytes. If you have a gazillion wallets, the size of the stake will be obviously much larger, so they're separate issues.
What's the pricing model?
So the mission of the company is obviously to be non-prohibitive, and we're here to encourage adoption. That's why we go to hackathons, and that's why we were introduced as business development, but I call it more developer evangelism. So we're not looking for a check up front. We really pursue a model on a case-by-case basis, but we only want to make money here. So we think it's a fantastic technology. It really speaks for itself. And if you can find room for it in your technology stack, of course, let's talk afterwards. So
just one other point on that. We try to match your revenue model. So however it is that you're monetizing what you're doing, we're not going to create a revenue model that's at odds with that. And that's to George's point. We only want to be making a little bit of money when you're making a lot, and not upside down.
Sir, yes, you can be on all of them. You were saying that we came back to one foot. How does you get, let's say, for example, how many of you
So the answer to that depends on whether we're talking about a permission network. Let me restate the question to make sure I got it myself. If you have a network, you want to add nodes dynamically to the network. How do you do that? Is that the question from the How do you prevent civil attacks? That's part of the question. Okay, so in a permission network, there's a governing body that has set up some policy or rules that describe what types of members they will add to the system. And that's easy. You know, the credit unions, they'll decide what it means to be a credit union, and they will only allow other credit unions into the network of credit unions. That was not hard. If it's an open network, when anybody can join or stand up a node in the network, how do you prevent, say, a government, hypothetically, from standing up a million nodes all at once and overwhelming the system? Overwhelming the system in the sense that they've just gotten more than a third plus one of the nodes and they can control the consensus. In that case, you have to have a scarce resource that is used to prevent a single party from financially being able to, or prosper, maybe it's not just financial, from a business process, not being able to do exactly that, stand up enough nodes that they can take over the voting majority, or not majority, but a third plus one of the votes, and control the consensus outcome. There are a lot of different solutions to that. That's what proof of stake is all about. And there are different models for how to achieve that. But basically, you just have to have some scarce, generally speaking, you have to have some scarce resource. And it costs, quote, unquote, something. It costs the person something to stand up a node. And in mass or at scale, it costs enough that no one economically can achieve it. So if we were talking about exactly how we would do it, that's a separate conversation, but you know, generally you have to have scarce resources.
Just now you mentioned assumptions that the other
know, it's interesting. This really is a question for Lehman. But what I can say is, there is a definition of there's a definition of being Byzantine fault tolerant, BFT, that each algorithm has to applies, let me say it that way, that applies to any given algorithm based on the assumptions that have been made. Right? And so it's not like somebody that is developing a leader-based system says, I'm going to make some assumptions because I want to be partially synchronous BFT. They are partially synchronous BFT because they are a leader-based algorithm. In our case, we are asynchronous BFT because the algorithm has a set of properties that are emergent. And the same assumptions that cause the other algorithms to be partially don't apply. Like there's no leader, for example. And this fairness property, it's separate, it's formally defined, and it's proven. So it's not the case that there are any assumptions that we can point to that sort of weaken the technology. If it were the case, then we wouldn't be able to claim we're asynchronous BFT. Does that make sense? We achieve the definition of asynchronous BFT, and we didn't make up the definition. And if there were assumptions that helped us cheat in some way, by definition, we wouldn't be asynchronous BFT, we'd be less. I know it's kind of sort of like circular reasoning, but I guess the answer to your question is no. There are no assumptions.
If you have any questions, you're welcome to email
any one of us, Matt@swirls.com, Jordan@swirls.com, and Edgar@swirls.com. And we also invite all of you, if you're not already in the group, we have a couple of Telegram groups that are that you're welcome to join in, the Hashgraph community, the Hashgraph developer group, and the Hashgraph announcement group. So you can keep in touch with us through either any of these three Telegram groups. Thank you very much.